Hello and welcome to NPTEL MOOC on electromagnetic guided waves, electromagnetic waves in guided and wireless media. This is our module 8. So in this module we are going to look at additional applications of Smith chart. I will mostly be giving you again a high level version of the Smith chart thing. So you will have to have your Smith charts, pencil, compass, scale and other things to verify my calculations. And doing so, couple of problems will give you a good handle on how to use Smith charts. Okay. So we will look at two applications of Smith chart. One, we have already seen the application, but we did not mention it until the end of the problem. Shunt stub matching. You are familiar with the basic idea. You have this main transmission line which is terminated with some unknown load ZL, and this transmission line has to be matched to the characteristic impedance of the main transmission line. We are going to assume that the lines are lossless to simplify our calculations. And the procedure also, you know, you need to connect a stub of appropriate termination, whether it would be an open circuited termination or it could be a short circuited termination. Both will actually work, but then depending on which termination you have chosen, the length of that stub will change. So we will denote the length by D2 and the position at which you are going to place this stub as D1. Okay. In the previous problem, you were given D1, given D2, you were given Z0 and ZL, and you were asked to find out what is the input impedance at this particular plane, or rather we found that it is easier to deal with admittances, and therefore we were asked to find out what is the normalized input admittance at this plane, and we found that this was actually equal to 1. Okay, and it was equal to 1 because two things happened. One, you started off with ZL and then you converted first ZL to ZL bar. From ZL bar you converted that into YL bar. Right. So that was actually the admittance that you would see right at the load point itself. And then by moving YL bar, starting from the point YL bar and moving on to the WTG scale, that is clockwise from the WTG scale, what you did was to find the intersection, or rather it turned out that way, but now you're going to do this one. So what you found was the new point, which we called as say YL bar, was actually equal to 1 plus some JB, where B was the reactance that you found. B could be positive or negative, doesn't matter. I am just writing it as 1 plus JB. It could equally be 1 plus or 1 minus JB, when B is negative. So what you found was starting from YL, right, to move to YL bar was actually the position where the constant SWR corresponding to ZL intersected with unity or unit circle on the Smith chart. Unit circle on the Smith chart was given by R equal to 1. This is a special circle, and the point where the constant SWR circle and the R equal to 1 circle, this is constant SWR circle somewhere. Okay, and when these two intersected, you obtained the impedance or the admittance YL bar as some form 1 plus JB. And what this stub actually did was to cancel off this B, that is the reactive part, by starting with either an open circuit or a short circuit in such a way that this YS prime, which was the stub admittance, was exactly equal to minus JB. Okay. So if, for example, YL prime was 1 plus J2, then the stub is supposed to give you minus J2. If the YL bar admittance is 1 minus J2, then the stub is going to give you plus J2, right? So this is the basic idea, and the distance D2 in order to give you that admittance can be found again by Smith chart. Okay, so hopefully this process is very clear. We are going to solve a simple problem, right, and then we will see how to obtain this D1 and D2. Okay, let's assume that someone has already calculated what is the normalized load impedance, which is ZL bar, and this is given by 1 plus J2. Okay, if we are already given what is 1 plus J2, then we really need not do anything else. You simply have to design D2. Okay, of course, here the problem is that you need to place the stub right at the load itself. Okay, this problem of placing the load right at the load itself does not in any way make it impractical, because these are connections done in the parallel manner. If it was series, yes, then you had to make some space for this line to be placed in series, and that would have created a little bit of a problem. But because you are going to connect in parallel, you can simply connect right at the source itself, that is make D1 equal to 0, and simply choose the length D2 appropriately to convert either an open circuited line, we will take that in this problem, into minus J2. So all that you are trying to do is to obtain the length of the line such that you get minus J2. And how do you do that? Well, we know that you are going to be moving on the outer circle, because an open circuited impedance will be located here, but then after transforming it into the admittance, you are going to start at this point, which we called as B. This was point A, right? A corresponding to the open circuit impedance, B corresponding to the open circuit admittance. Okay, so the open circuit admittance is located at B, and on this outer circle you are going to move clockwise, okay, over a length D2, right, such that you get, or you land up at minus J2, right? And then you find out how much you have moved. You probably have moved all the way 0.25 anyway to land up to a negative value of J, and then you would have moved some additional distance. Okay, so you have moved this distance, and what you get is whatever the value. So this is about you can find this, so whatever the length that you have found, so 0.25 plus, I think this is about 0.11, so there is a total distance of 0.36 lambda that you have moved. Please verify the calculation, I may be wrong in one of these numbers, but I do know that B to A distance is 0.25, and then you have to move an additional distance to reach this point, which is C, which gives you YS bar equals minus J2. Okay. Now, if this problem seemed very simple to you, let's alter the problem here by making the real part to be different than Z0. So let us say take the real part to be say 0.5, and then I will still keep this as plus J2, the load, normalized load impedance there, so that I can find out what would be the distance D1 and D2. Now, of course, I can't place it right on the load point itself, that is clearly not possible, because the real part is not equal to 1. So I have to keep the stub at a distance D1 in such a way that after transforming, the real part 0.5 would become 1, and then you have whatever the leftover for the susceptance that you need to cancel. Okay, so we will do that again by going back to the Smith chart, but this time our objective is to determine both D1 as well as D2. Again, this is my skeleton of the Smith chart, this is my unit circle, okay, and then I have this other thing, then I have this 0.5 circle, okay, and then I need J2, so let me draw one additional arc. So this 0.5 plus J2 ZL bar will be located somewhere over here, we will call this as A, but then I am not really working with impedances, I need to work with admittance. So I first draw the constant SWR circle, okay, so this green line is my constant SWR circle, and then I move to the opposite point here to land at point B, and point B would give me the equivalent admittance YL bar. Okay, so point B is where you are actually looking at YL bar, and now on this constant SWR circle you have to move until you reach, or you reach the point C, where you are actually landing between the intersection of this R equal to 1 circle and the SWR circle. You look at this blue circle, which is R equal to 1, and this circle, which is green circle, which is point C, and at point C you have something like 1 plus J, maybe this is 3 or something, no, I am not obtaining the correct answers here, maybe it is J or 2.2 something, you can find out what exactly is the value here after you have drawn the constant SWR circle. Okay, so point C would correspond to YL bar. Okay, ZL will correspond to point A, YL will correspond to point B, and after transforming YL through a length D1 you get YL bar. So what length did we transform? We moved a distance on the WTG scale from D prime, right, all the way up to C prime, right? So this point was C prime, and the intersection of these two points was the point C that we have found out. Okay, so this length from B prime to C prime arc length will be given by D1. Now you could observe an interesting thing. as you keep moving along this green line, right, you will actually land up at one additional cross section or additional intersection, which we can call it as say D, and then D prime, the arc length B prime D prime, you know, is also another solution which we will call as D1 prime for the stub position. So you could choose either to place a stub at the arc length B prime C prime, okay, where the impedance is of the nature 1 plus J, some positive value of B, or you could place the stub at a length D1 prime where the admittance YL prime is actually of the form 1 minus J something, okay. So both are actually possible, and you can pick one of the solutions. So let's arbitrarily pick the solution to be D1. You want to place the stub as close as possible to the load that is there, okay. So you don't want to place it too far from the load, because the lines are usually not lossless, they are actually lossy. So the longer the line that you use, the distance that you make D1, then the chances are there that there is excessive loss accumulated there. So you keep D1 you know, short, and then after you have placed D1 and noted down what is the value of the impedance, which in this case, or admittance, which is in this case is roughly say 1 plus J 2.2. You can again, depending on whether you have an open circuited stub or a short circuited stub, you can start from this point which corresponds to open circuit admittance, or this point which corresponds to short circuit admittance, and move a certain length such that you make or you get minus J B. B in this case is 2.2, let's say. So you need to simply move on the outer circle and then move appropriately, okay. And you can also notice that if you started off with a short circuit and you want a negative value of B, that is, you know, admittance to be susceptance to be negative, you will be covering a shorter distance than you start with an open circuited stub, okay. And in fact, in most printed circuit boards, it is kind of easier to deal with short circuited stubs rather than open circuited stub, simply because open circuited means there is a chance for radiation also happening, okay. So this completes our shunt stub matching network. We have seen two cases where the real part is already equal to 1, in which case the stub is located right at the load itself, but the length is chosen in such a way that the susceptance offered is minus of whatever the real imaginary part of the load ZL is, or the load admittance YL is. And if the admittance does not have a real part equal to 1 to begin with, then you have to move the stub length such that you get that real part equal to 1. And you try and, you know, use a combination such that you have D1 and D2 to be as small as possible, but it turns out that you can't simultaneously satisfy both of them. And it also you know, happens that this kind of a matching is not really broadband, meaning that this match is very, very good for a given frequency, but as you move away from that frequency of operation, for example, when a pulse is traveling, the pulse spectrum is usually, you know, non-zero around that frequency where you have designed, right? Then in that case, what would happen is different frequency components will be slightly seeing different values of the you know, equivalent input impedance Y in, meaning that the reflection coefficient will not be zero over a small band, okay. In fact, if you plot the magnitude of reflection coefficient between Y in and Z naught for different frequencies, you will see that it will be equal to 0 exactly at the design frequency F naught, but then as you move away, magnitude of gamma quickly becomes larger, okay. There are many techniques to make this broadband, okay. There are many techniques to make it even broadband as possible, but that would involve, you know, having more design parameters, and those design parameters means you are going to have more than one stub. So in fact, you can actually have another stub placed at a distance. Sometimes you can also have a third stub placed, and so on and so forth, okay. So we are completely not done with impedance matching. We will take up this subject later on when we look at plane waves and, you know, interaction of plane waves between two media. Many of the concepts that we have discussed so far will be applied again there as well, and those are also very interesting cases where, interestingly, even for the wave cases, you can actually use this Smith chart. You can convert all those problems of uniform plane waves into equivalent transmission line problems and then work with Smith charts, and that is what we are going to do later on. Thank you very much.